Hi guys, and welcome to week 13. This week we are going to talk about the history of the English language. Up until this point in the semester, we've briefly touched about the history. We've briefly covered random events here and there. But today we're going to take it back to the beginning and cover the whole thing. I actually found this lecture very interesting when I was preparing for it, so I think you might too, especially if you have any interest in history. So it's kind of cool. We're going to use this infographic today to kind of support the lecture and explore the topic. We'll hop between this infographic and a couple slides, but the infographic is available to you next to, it's a link right next to where you found this lecture in Canvas. So we'll go back and forth between the two, the infographic and some slides. When we talk about the history of the English language, we need to realize that we're also talking about the history of a people group. In this case, the people group would be the English people and the British Islands. To understand how the English language has been shaped, we have to understand the various wars and conflicts and conquerings that occurred involving the English people and the English people that participated in it. In the beginning, you had, so way back before this area was occupied, the British Islands, I'm going to refer to this as England and the United Kingdom because that's what we call it today. But keep in mind, it didn't have that name at this point. But we had a group of people from India migrate up through Europe and land on the British Islands. And those people that migrated spoke Celtic languages. So that was the first language to enter this region of the world. Around 55 BC, so the BC means before Christ, if you didn't know what that acronym meant, the Romans at that time, whole different people group, right? But the Romans were like the powerhouse of the world, and they were pretty much conquering and settling everywhere. So they settled in England, the area we now call England, around 55 BC. And at this time, keep in mind, English was not a language, but I'm pointing out that at this time we actually had people living there and they were now using Celtic and Latin, Latin being the language that the Romans brought in. So the Romans stayed there for quite a while. They ruled this area until around 410 AD, which means after death. So 465 years, essentially. So I want to point out one thing, even with the length of time that Rome was in this England, Britain area, there are only about 200 words with Roman origin that are left in our modern day English. So many of, at that time when the Romans came in, many of the people that were using Latin were just the merchants or the soldiers, the Roman soldiers. It wasn't a language that took over the Celtic language. But some borrowing occurred at the time. The Celtic language borrowed some words such as wall, belt, candle, and wine. Those are words that at this point entered that region and were borrowed, and we actually still use those today. But considering how long the Romans were there, they're aren't that many words from the Roman language, respectively, that we have still in our lexicon. But when pointing out that these were the, some of the earliest remnants of this pre-English time period, when English is starting to be created, right? So around this time, 410 AD, the Roman Empire was also crumbling. So they've been there and they've been spread out throughout the world for several hundred years, but their empire is falling apart. So they left. They left a lot of areas, but they also left what we call England. And when they left, they also took their soldiers and their forces with them. So this land now is very susceptible to invasion, right? The ruling group has left and they have no army. So at this point, another group of tribes invades this area. And those tribes were the Angles, Saxons, Jutes, and Frisians. I don't often hear about the Jutes and Frisians, and I'll explain why in a second. These tribes came in, though, and they attacked, and they conquered these British islands. And when they came in, they brought in their own language. And the languages they spoke were basically some type of Germanic languages. So they were early versions of German language. At that point, we can call this the beginning point of English when these soldier or when these tribes came in. So if you've heard the term Anglo-Saxon language or Anglo-Saxon, that's where it came from, was this juncture in history, the names of the tribes, Anglos and Saxons. I don't know why the Jutes and the Frisians don't get a call out on that, but it's we call it the Anglo-Saxon. Anglo-Saxon has to do with speaking English, being an English speaker, and it comes back to this point in history. That's where we get that term. This is the point in history where we see Old English developed, the very first baby version of English. And about one third of our modern English we use today has Anglo-Saxon roots to this time in history. Words such as baffle, earth, loaf, those words are rooted back to this time, hundreds and hundreds of years ago, when these tribes invaded this area of the world, Britain. So now if you remember, we said in prior lectures that out of the top 1,000 words we use in the English language, most of them were native to us. I said they were native, right? And I said they were native because they had Germanic roots. This is exactly what I was talking about when I said that. Those words are native, as in they are tied back to this Anglo-Saxon time period where English was being birthed. So another thing that's interesting to look at, though, with words that came out of this time, words like Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, these were actually days of the week, weeks, days of the week named after gods that were part of the religions at that time. So Tues was a god, and he was given a day to be celebrated on, and that day was then called Tuesday. That's where that came from. So I think that's interesting. All that said, this is the basis of Old English. 450 AD, when these tribes came in, these tribes pretty much ran that place until about 1000 to 1100 AD. The exact time period there is unknown. It varies in the literature, it seems like, but essentially they were there, let's say 600 years, the Anglos and Saxons ruling this area. And we'll come back to what happens in at that point when it ended. We'll come back to that in a few minutes. But so at this point, you've had the Celtic speakers invaded by the Romans, which kind of brought in some Latin, and then Romans left. But then we had these Germanic speakers, the Anglos and Saxons, come in. So we've had, three touch points at this point, creating this language. Around the 7th century, so years and years later, we get Latin coming back into the country again. So Latin left with the Romans when their empire crashed, but it came back. And this is because, oh, and I'm sorry, I'm skipping around. So Latin comes back into the language. The Latin speakers named the British islands Anglia. So they gave, keep in mind, we're not called, you're, it's not called Britain yet or England, none of that. It's they named this group of islands, the British Islands, Anglia, the land of the Angles, playing back to the Anglo-Saxons, right? And from Angles, interesting enough, this is where the word English comes from. So Angles, Ingles, English, it kind of, I'm not sure of the exact times it morphed, but it is from the word Angles that the pronunciation of English derived. So that's pretty cool. So when we're looking at this history of language, it's kind of like looking at a family tree. So at the top of this language family, of this language family tree for English is this West Germanic group, of a German subfamily of the Indo-European family of languages. I'll get into what some of these terms mean in a minute, but again, it's like we're looking at a family tree. It's like saying English is the English's great grand English's great grandma's daughter's daughter's daughter, right? So we're an ancestor of all these things. That's what we're talking about. And we can visually see this imagery using a real tree. So the leaves represent English, and they come from the branches, which are West Germanic, and so forth and so forth. So I want to get into some of those terms I just discussed, which was Indo-European. So we have this term here called Proto-Indo-European. When we look at this, Proto-Indo-European is this top language, and I'm going to define that in a minute, but it's a language. And from that language, we get all these other languages. We look at these languages on this screen in that top row, and we know they all have stuff in common. They all have similarities, but we're not sure which one language is the top of this family tree. At some point, there must have been a proto-language, what we're calling a Proto-Indo-European language, that represented, that basically fed and create off of that one language, all these other languages were created. So this Proto-Indo-European language is the grandmother of all these relative languages right here. We call it a proto-language because it's a prototype, and these are called Indo-European. So prototype Indo-European, because Indo means coming from India. Remember, the Celtic speakers migrated from India through Europe, and European because they migrated to Europe. So Indo-European, from India to Europe. That's where that comes from. So one of the offshoots of Proto-Indo-European is Germanic. And this is the word we've been using, right? And you'll notice there's a North Germanic and a West Germanic. And West Germanic is where English takes its roots. The Anglos and Saxons, they were West Germanic speakers. So this is just to show you how we arrive at the point when I say that English has Germanic roots. This is a visual to show you that. And I don't know if any of you have tried to learn German before, but German is like our closest relative sister. It has grammar and syntax, lexical units, so words, phonology, sounds, rules that are very similar to English. And why? Because that's where our roots are. So it's kind of cool. But you might, one thing I want to point out here before we move from this slide is that there's this funny dotted line going from French to English, and we're going to come back to that in a second, but it is something to make note of. Oh, real quick, here's some more words that come from the Germanic tribe contact. So when the Anglos and Saxons came in, right? And we talked about Tuesday as a word that came from that time. So this is when the Romans left and the four groups invaded. Here's some more words that entered what's became Old English and words that we still use today. So going back to our infograph though, Latin comes in again in our it touches English again around 591 AD. Because at this time, Christian missionaries were coming along and they were bringing with them these religious documents, these different religious texts, and they were sharing their religion. And this is the point where words like mass and martyr and bishop entered this region of the world, so entered Anglia, the British Islands, and that's when they therefore entered the English language. We have next we have another set of invasions. So all of those old English speakers that are living there in England are now going to be invaded by Vikings, right? And so old English is spoken, but they're going to be invaded by Vikings that also speak a Germanic language, but not West Germanic, not where the Anglos and Saxon came from. These speakers speak a Northern Germanic language called Old Norse. And you'll see that on the last, that little family tree slide I showed you. So they speak Old Norse. We have these Vikings, these rough guys come in, they're roughing up the place. And a lot of the words that English borrows at this point or picks up from this point in history are very violent words. So you saw on your last assignment, one of your last assignments, that we have the word club from this language because people were being knocked or clubbed. Knocked over with clubs at that time. And this is where other words like hell and ransack enter the English language. So it was a very violent time, and the words we picked up at that time are definitely an indication of that. Well, Vikings did what Vikings do, and then they left. They took off, they came and messed up the place, then they left. But what happens next is probably one of the most significant events in the English language history. And I had briefly mentioned earlier we were going to talk about what happened to Old English when I said the Old English ran from like 450 AD when the Anglo-Saxon tribes came in through around, 1100 AD. This is what happened. Around this time, King William of Normandy conquers England. This is around, like I said, 1066 AD or 1100 AD. This guy from France, King William, invades and he conquers England. They come in, they set up camp. They didn't just rough up the place like the Vikings, they camp there. They have invaded and they're going to stay. So now the French were the ruling class of this area. And what that meant was that anybody at that time who had wealth or prestige, they spoke French. And those that didn't have those things, like farmers, spoke English. It's interesting because, here for a while, this country, this region, had a bilingual society. French and English were both dominant languages in this region, though one was associated with the upper class and one with the lower class. French being upper class, English being lower class. You can recall what I said about borrowing a few weeks ago, when we talked about borrowing. This is a really interesting point for turning point for English. So when I talked about words being borrowed in the English language, we talked about it being a one-way street. Lower prestige languages borrow words from higher prestige languages. It doesn't work the other way around. So at this time, English was, if they borrowed words, they were borrowing words from French, which because that was the high prestige language at that point in history. Many words we use today came into the English language from this time period, but because we had a bilingual society at that time, we now sometimes have two words that exist for one item. So I want to let you look at this animal part of the infograph as an example. Let's talk about cow and beef. Cow, the word cow, was the English word for what we think of a cow, the living animal cow. The French word for cow was beef. I mean, a very, it's, I'm not saying it right, but it's basically very close to the word beef. So when we talk about the living animal that we eat, we call, in English, we call it a cow, and the French would call that same thing beef, essentially. But what's interesting is because both the words meant the same thing, their meaning got kind of divided, in the sense that, so the French were this prestigious group of people. They weren't working with cows. They were eating them. They weren't having to handle the cows and the livestock. They just enjoyed the meat as a meal. So they would call this meat beef because that's what they also called a cow, was beef. Now the farmers and the English speakers at that time, they were handling the livestock, but they weren't necessarily eating it. That wasn't, this was, they were feeding the wealthy, essentially. And they called this animal a cow. But what happened over time is that I'm trying to th articulate it best, that there became a difference that when you use the English word cow, you were talking about the live animal, but when you were using the French word beef, you were talking about the meat of the animal. And this is that point in history where many words split like that. So technically, however you pronounce beef in French, it means both cow and the meat of the animal. But in English, to us, beef represents just the meat, and cow pretty much represents just the living animal. I know we can say, I'm going to go get a cow burger. We don't say that, but we could say that, and we know what we mean. But generally, beef is what we're talking about. We're talking about the meat of the animal. So those words just ended up taking on two different connotations because of what was going on in history at that time. Let's jump back over to our Proto-Indo-European chart here. So after the Norman invasion, which is that history event I just told you about, we can go back to the dotted line on this page and make sense of it. This event, this Norman invasion, was so significant that even though English is a Germanic language, we actually had more influence from the Latin family of languages. We have more influence from the Latin family of languages, which is why we have this dotted line, than we do the Germanic family. We can kind of look at this like adoption. Our biological parents, our genes are with our biological parents, and that is in the West Germanic family. But our adopted parents are the French, the Latin languages. I was laughing though at that analogy because maybe adoption is too nice of a word because keep in mind they invaded England, so perhaps we should call them our abductors instead of our adopters. But funny enough, both the word abductor and adopter are both Latin words, so screw those guys. No, I'm just kidding. So we have a lot in common with Latin languages because of this French invasion. Not just French, but all of these Latin languages. You can see them listed here. And this group, French, Spanish, Italian, what you're seeing under that Latin heading, they are what we call the Romance languages. And when I say romance, I don't mean romantic as in love. We're actually talking about the Romans. The Romance languages, we're not talking about relationships. We're talking about the Romans and Rome and the language of the Romans, which was Latin. So when we say Romance languages, that English is very close to the Romance languages. We mean we're talking about English being close to any language that was derived from Latin, such as French, Spanish, and Italian. English is not a Romance language, but there are a lot of similarities because of this French invasion between English and these Romance languages, because of this contact with French and English at that point in the Norman invasion. So on your last assignment, actually, if you were given the French words and you had said that those words came from Latin, that in some way is indeed still correct because French words are likely a derivative of Latin. You can see that on this chart. But it's not correct for that assignment because when we borrowed them, when English borrowed that word, we were not borrowing them from the Latin speakers, we were borrowing them from the French speakers. So, all that said, this time period was so radically important to the English language that instead of calling it Old English, like it was with the Anglos and Saxons and those several hundred years they were there. We've now entered at this point in history a new era of English, and this new era is what we call Middle English. So back to the infograph. These guys stayed in the area a long time, something like 200 years, leaving in, let's see, when did they leave? 1337, and this began what was known as the 100-Year War. And 100-Year War is kind of a misnomer because it actually lasted like 116 years. So the English were fighting the French, and the English prevailed and officially kicked out the French in 1450. And all of a sudden, English has now replaced French for the first time as the official unofficial language of the country. So Parliament, which is their government, this is the first time you can imagine Parliament, their government, was conducted in French the last several hundred years. And this is the first time that it was being conducted in English after this 100-Year War, this Middle English that we have. So now English is the dominant language in, again in this area, in this region. Next, what happened is also very interesting. So now English has been radically changed because of this influence of the French. But what also happened is so we have this Middle English, right? So they're Middle English, they're free, they can use the language, the French are out of the country. But what's also happening in the global community is the Renaissance. The Renaissance is this era where all of a sudden Latin and Greek culture were pretty much being elevated as this idea civilization. And so the world kind of looked up to these languages and cultures, even though at this point Latin had died out. I guess this was more of a nostalgia. There was like a nostalgia for Latin. And so people started getting interested in the world in art and cultural ideas that were that had roots in Greek and Latin. This is where we get words like comedy and tragedy. So the Renaissance is going on globally, this era, and it brought a lot of words into English at that time. This was not the same. You can look at here again, Greek, well, Greek for the first time, right? But Latin is touching the English language again. But this is not the same contact we've discussed so far in this lecture. This the past points where these other languages have come into contact with each other, this has been literal contact, like invaders or missionaries, like people have been physically in your place bringing this language to you. Alternatively, this like interest all of a sudden, global interest in Greek and Latin, was a new type of contact. It wasn't like a physical presence of it. The contact was kind of cultural, like a shift in global culture. All of a sudden wanting, you know, these English, Middle English speakers in England were wanting to hop on this Greek and Latin trend in order to look prestigious like the rest of the world. So weird stuff starts happening during this time. For example, with the word, the English word debt, like I owe a debt to you, it has a random B in it, right? D-E-B-T. What's interesting is that before the Renaissance, debt was actually spelled in Middle English as D-E-T, which makes sense, right? We don't say or pronounce the B in the word debt. We say it much like the spelling D-E-T. There was no B in it. Then all of a sudden, people were fascinated with these classical cultures, Greek and Latin. And so to make English seem more credible, they changed the spelling to D-E-B-T because the Latin word for debt, I think it was debutune, has a B in it. So these Middle English speakers are thinking, if we stick a B in our version, that will make us seem like we're part of these classical cultures. It's especially crazy to think about now because English is a very prestigious language now, so that's not something we would do now. But at this point in history, they didn't have legitimacy or language prestige, you know. They just got rid of the French, right? So they're clamoring for an identity. So some of the words we have in English now have these silent letters in it. Not all of them, but a majority of them come from this idea and this shift and the influence of the Renaissance era at this time. And one more point about the Renaissance. During this Renaissance era, 10,000 to 12,000 Latin words, mostly Latin words, and some were Greek, entered the English language during this time. So it was definitely influential on the formation of English. But about this time, a couple other things happened also, like the invention of the printing press, which made English more accessible to people. It also modified some of the ways that we would spell things because on the printing press, they would have these block letters. And so if they didn't have enough letters for a certain word, they would look for ways to abbreviate or omit maybe a word that had two B's in it down to one. So just to get things to fit on a page. So because of that, it actually then led to some significant spelling changes in some of the English words we have, just the printing press alone. But we also, at this time, get the establishment of the King James Bible, which we get actually a ton of words and idioms from, like heart's desire, writing on the wall, ends of the earth, those phrases that you hear, they root back all the way to the King James Bible. And we also have playwrights like Shakespeare. So we get a lot of weird phraseology from him as well, like dead as a doornail. That's from his work. So as English became more of a legitimate language and the English people began to govern themselves, one of their strategies was to start colonizing. So they started heading out to the ends of the earth and colonizing. And it's at this point in history you see a great expansion of the English Empire. So you can imagine these people that are going out to colonize, they're not only taking English with them, but they are also borrowing then on occasion terms from the indigenous people that live in these places. And the thing, of course, then that changed all of our lives when the British came to North America. This was the 17th and 18th centuries, and of course they brought with them the English language. So we see the establishment of American English now. At this point in the Americas, during this migration over, right, and this colonizing of the Americas, this Middle English now is in contact with Native American languages, Dutch, German, and Italian. And we begin to borrow more words, and you can see examples right here. But what's really fascinating is that contact here with like Italian If you think about it, Italy and England are not really that geographically far apart from each other in Europe. So you'd think because they are so geographically close that there would have been some sort of contact and language borrowing from contact back in Europe. And the same with Spain. Spain and England are essentially neighbors. But nope, you don't see any borrowing over the course of the English history at this point from Italian or Spain. It's not until everyone basically hopped the pond and landed here in the North Americas. And then all of a sudden, when there were all these turf wars going on, all these languages begin to contact each other. So the borrowing that's in English, that's from Spanish, did not come from Spain and England in Europe. It came from interaction here when America was first being colonized. So at this point, borrowing, the English language, borrowing words from other languages began to slow down dramatically because English started to become a language associated with power and dominance. English is now used globally, and instead of borrowing words, the process has reversed. The language has now become the prestigious language, and many other languages in the world actually borrow words from English. There is some modern day contact, as you saw in the research you did previously. We still occasionally borrow words from different languages, often for novelty or for new ideas like brands, foods, and technologies. That's a great time to borrow a word, especially with countries like Japan, where we do a lot of trading with the country. There is small levels of borrowing, but usually, as we talked about in previous lectures, it's for in specific domains like the sciences or the arts or foods, right? Cultural borrowing. So, what does the future hold for English? We don't know. We know that English is a global language, that there are more non-native speakers of English than native speakers. And later this week, you get to hear from David Crystal, who is going to talk about where English is heading. One last thing to share with you guys. If you look at this pie in terms of modern English, so after the colonization, the British Empire went out and colonized. We then moved from Middle English to Modern English. So we had Old English, Middle English, Modern English. In Modern English, 26% of our words come from Germanic languages. So we're talking about when the Anglos and Saxons and the Vikings came in, right? 29% of our words are French. So when our abductors, the French, the Norman invasion, 29% are from Latin, and you saw from this lecture, Latin has touched the English language several times at several different points, especially in the Renaissance. And also, it was during that Renaissance period where we get 6%, that 6% of our language is made up of Greek terms. And it was from that Renaissance period. We've got the 6% from other languages, and this is where Dutch, Spanish, Japanese, Italian, that's what we mean by other languages, ones that we've had small amounts of contact with, but really not the historical big milestones we've talked about. There's this other 4% that I don't think should be on here, and it's words that come from names. So we called that, do you remember what we called that? It's called an eponym. We covered that in our word borrowing or word formation process lecture, I think 2 weeks ago. So eponyms are words that come from someone's name. We talked about the examples we had at that time were Scrooge, I think, don't be a Scrooge, or a Romeo, right? Or Dumbo, or no, I'm sorry, Jumbo. Jumbo was the name of an elephant, and then it became the elephant's name. We begin to use the word jumbo to mean anything large, right? I learned a new one recently that I thought I'd share, and it's the word Stan. And it's actually in the dictionary, and Stan means like over the head fanatic. And it's an eponym because maybe you guys already knew this. I just learned this for the first time. But Stan means basically stalkerish fan, right? And it comes from that song by Eminem, however many years ago, where that song where he writes about his fan. Named Stan, and Stan would write him all these letters all the time. So, since that song, the word Stan now has become the name Stan now is an eponym to mean fanatic. So I thought that was interesting. Okay, nonetheless, I don't think that 4% should be in this chart technically. But that wraps up this lesson. I know it was long, but it was probably one of my favorites to teach. Let me know if you have any questions, and good luck on your quiz this week. Thanks.